You know, many times we all like to have encounters with God. Encounters with God not meaning that we just like to be tickled by spiritual experiences or spiritual blessings. That should not be our motive. Like most Christians, either knowingly or unknowingly, say like this: I like to see an angel. I like to do this. I like that. I like this. That should not be our motive for just simply liking this or liking that. That is equivalent to being just tickled. Tickled and make me feel good, make me feel happy, those kind of things. You know, from scriptures, we know one thing. God does not satisfy mere curiosities. What is His desire? His desire is to make Himself known to His people. That is His desire. His desire to manifest Himself to His people is more than our desire to see Him. A very good example is found in Exodus chapter 19, where before the children of Israel ever had any knowledge of seeing the Holy God, the Lord God Himself told the prophet Moses, I want to show myself to my people. But they must be made ready to meet me. So often at times, the problem is not with God showing Himself to us. The problem is we are not ready to see Him. That is the problem. Even if He comes and stands before us, we can't see Him because we are not ready or our hearts are not sanctified yet. Our ears are still deaf. Our eyes are blind. Eyes are blind, ears are deaf, and the mouth is dumb. Why? Because we are filled with too much of the cares of this world, the things of this world. So unless and until all these are removed, we are not able to see the Holy God. See, when God told the prophet Moses, I want to show myself to the people, He told him, prepare them for 3 days. So one day was not enough. Prepare them for 3 days. Let them wash themselves. Let them stay away from sexual impurities. Their hearts must be clean. Their minds must be clean. Their bodies must be clean. So 3 days of preparation to sanctify themselves. And after the third day, the Lord God appeared before them. Now if you read Revelation chapter 1 and Ezekiel chapter 1, when the prophets saw the glory of God, the scripture says they fell down as one who is dead. They couldn't stand before the glory of God. So let me reiterate one more time. It is the desire of God to show Himself to His people. The people of God must make themselves ready to be prepared to stand in His presence. You know, many times you have heard it been said, oh, God sees the heart, He doesn't see the body. Have you heard that been said? But body language is also important. You cannot deny that. Body language is important. If your heart is humbled, your body will automatically kneel down before the presence of the living God. So that is a body language that shows what has taken place in your heart. If you have the fear of God ruling your heart and reverence for God ruling in your heart, automatically, you cannot simply sit on your chairs to meet with the glory of God. You will automatically, without a word being said, either prostrate yourselves before the presence of God or kneel down before the presence of God. See, body language is important. And you may have heard this being said, we can pray anytime we like, when you're riding, when you're bathing, you're doing cooking, whatever. However, there is also this thing called meeting God at set times. If you read Job chapter 1 and chapter 2, there it says, on a certain day, appointed day, the sons of God came to present themselves before God. See, that does not mean they didn't present themselves all other days. They do, but there is a certain appointed time where everybody must come to present themselves before God. So you can pray anytime you like, whenever you like. There's no bar to all that. However, there is a God-appointed time to come and present ourselves to Him. So these are some rudimentary elements in walking with God. All these are reflections of showing reverence to God. For example, God specifically said, 6 days you shall work, the seventh day belongs to me. On that day, come and present yourselves to me. So that is God's appointed day. We cannot choose and go when to see God. Of course, you can see any God anytime. Besides all the anytime, there is one appointed day. That's God's day. That day doesn't belong to anybody. Doesn't even belong to you. One day, come and present yourself to me. So these are some rudiments. Now, why am I telling you all this? I just had a little encounter with God during the last song that was sung by our dear daughter Brittany, when she came up to play the keyboard and she started singing the song on the Holy God. I just began to meditate on the words of the song. How great He looks like. He looks like Jasper. He looks like Sardis. As I was meditating those songs, I just went deeper into the meditation, pondering how glorious the sight must have been for John to see that scene in Revelation chapter 4. How it must have been. How he must have felt. As I pondered that deeper and deeper, then I realized why he fell as if one that was dead. As I keep on pondering this over and over and over, suddenly I saw the Lord Jesus Christ stand before me, and He explained to me the events that took place that day. And then that's when He said this. All these things that I'm sharing with you is what He shared with me during those brief moments. He said, my desire to show myself to my people is more than their desire to see me. My desire to manifest my kingdom, just like how the Apostle John saw, every one of us can have that blessed privilege to stand before the holy presence of God in the heavenly realm and see the kingdom of God like how John saw. Everybody, whether young believer or old believer, whether matured believer or immature believer, That doesn't matter. What matters is the sanctity of the heart, the purity of the heart. That matters the most. And they can all have encounters with God exactly like how the children of Israel had encounters with God before Mount Sinai. So what is preventing? So that's when he explained. Number one, the cares of the world are full in your hearts. So you need to get rid of all the cares of this world. Secondly, the impurity of the eyes. The eyes must be sanctified. The impurity of the heart. Without holiness, without purity, it is impossible to see God. So the heart must be cleansed. The mouth that praises God, the mouth that calls upon God, must be cleansed. It cannot be filled with wile or vanity. You spend all your time talking nonsense with one another, talking all grandmother, grandfather's stories, wasting all your precious time talking rubbish and joking unnecessarily. All that, you know, the words defiles us. It defiles your soul, it defiles the mind. And suddenly you come into the presence of God, you want to sing praises. You are singing praises out of defilement. See, that's why our praises don't rise up. The glory of God doesn't come down in the midst of all our praises, because the words that come out of our lips are coming out of a defiled lips, a corrupted lips. The mind is corrupted with so many useless things. So the mind is corrupted. How are we worshipping God with our mind? The Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 14, I will sing in the spirit, I will sing with my mind. Not only the spirit should sing, not only the spirit should pray, but also the mind must sing and pray in order for that to be in sync with the spirit. The mind must not be defiled. The mind must not be wandering here and there. Then you are in dichotomy. You are divided in two. The scripture says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all that is within you. So spirit, soul and body, all must be one in loving God, in seeking God. You cannot be divided and be a multitasker. Multitasking may be good for the world, but not when it comes to God. What is multitasking? Let me give you one very humorous example. It may be humorous, but don't laugh, because now we are serious. Okay? So, every afternoon from 3 to 5 is my prayer time that I spend praying in unknown tongues every day. So that one particular day, I had gone for some ministry trip and I've come back home after 3 weeks. So all the newspapers that the vendor sends have piled up, 2 weeks of newspapers on my dining table. So I was meaning to read them during my leisure time, but how is it possible to read 2 or 3 weeks of newspapers all in one go? Impossible, right? So I'd say during my free time, one day at a time, just look at the newspapers, no? So they were lying on the table, and then came my prayer time. So I began to pray in unknown tongues. So I always pace up and down in my whole house, going from room to room praying. So as I was praying, my eyes glanced on the newspapers. So I was also wondering, oh, when in the world am I going to find time to look at the newspapers? Suddenly a thought came to my mind. Why don't I multitask? Why? Because my spirit is praying. Let me also look at the newspapers And who knows, we can also pray for the events of the world at the same time. Don't you think like that? Okay. So, see, I am no better than any one of you. So while I was praying in unknown tongues, I opened the newspaper. I was looking, Rasha Mbarabraba, oh Rabba Baba 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 Baba. There was a problem. She said, Syria, Sorabaraba, Shataraba, Syria, Syria. So throughout the 2 hours of my prayer, I did all this and I finished through 2 weeks of newspapers. So I'm so happy that I have multitasked. So towards the end of my prayer time, at about 4:45, 4:50, suddenly I saw the presence of the Lord Jesus. He came and sat on the sofa where he usually sits. So as soon as I saw him, I went and knelt beside him, positioning myself to hear what he will say to me. He looked at me and he just simply said, without any condemnation, he simply said, you know, when you pray, you must pray with all your heart, with all your mind, with all that is within you, and not multitasking. So without pointing his finger to say what I had done was wrong, he just simply said, and his words convicted me what he was really getting into. So that day I learned, when we pray, when we meditate the word of God, the mind must also be involved in it. It shouldn't be distracted. It shouldn't be divided into two and do something else. That's very important. When you do that, then the mind is renewed and transformed. Like what Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2 tells us, the mind must be renewed and transformed. That can only take place when the mind and the spirit becomes one in prayer or in meditation of the word of God. When we do this, when we purpose to do this, then our hearts would begin to get sanctified. So this is number one. Number two, get rid of all the good for nothing cares of this world that crowd our hearts and our minds. What you shall eat, what you shall wear, where should we live, all these cares of this world, throw it out of your heart. Which is not easy to do because we have become very, very earth-minded, right? We are so earth-minded. We have been so programmed, trained, worrying for the children, worrying for the grandchildren. You know, all the amount of worrying is not changing our children or grandchildren. So why waste time worrying, isn't it? I once heard one wise man say like this, if your worries can change a situation, why worry? Right? Part two is, if your worries cannot change a situation, what is the use of worrying? Am I right, everybody? So if your worries cannot change or affect anything, why waste our time worrying? By worrying, you are only heaping upon you the cares of this world that make you very heavy. Two years ago, I was very, very troubled by so many things in our ministry. One was the huge amount of money that I needed to raise, $25 million for a building project that God told us to do. We needed to buy a piece of land, 8 acres of land, and then construct our television studio, our ministry headquarters. So I was very burdened by that. And with that burden in my heart, I came and sat before the Lord during my normal prayer times. And I saw a vision. In the vision, I saw a majestic bald eagle. And the eagle was walking from one end to another end, just walking about as if the eagle was in deep thoughts over something. Then as it was pacing up and down, later on the eagle tried to fly, but it could not fly. I was wondering why the eagle could not fly. Then I noticed the wings of the eagle were cemented. There were layers of cement all over the eagle's wings on both sides. So I thought to myself, oh, you poor eagle, where in the world did all these cements came upon you? And the eagle could not shrug itself off the cement, and as a result, it could not flap its wings and fly. So I was wondering, what is the meaning of this vision? And the Holy Spirit told me, that eagle is you. And the cement are all the cares and the worries that you are carrying in your heart. It's not able to lift you up to come and stand before my presence. He said, cast away all that. Commit all your ways unto me, because he cares for us. In God's appointed time, he will make all things sure. He will make all the provisions come one by one at its right time. When you can't add 1 inch to your stature, to your height, by worrying, why worry then? You know, recently I went through a medical checkup. Usually my height, now you Americans are following feet and inches, you know. So how shall I say it in feet and inches? I'm 162 cm. That is 5 feet and 3? 5 feet. Any mathematician here? Where is the mathematician? 5 feet 2. Okay, 5 feet 2. Oh, that short? Now do you know why the pulpit is always brought up? They only do that when I come. When all other speakers came, they always were standing down. Only for me, it comes up for 5'2". So I always know I'm 5'2". When I went for this medical checkup, they found and they measured me, they said, you have 5 inches, 5 feet. I said, that's not possible. We should be growing taller, not growing shorter. So the nurse, she said, are you really sure you're 5'2"? I said, of course. I've been 5'2" for the last 5 decades. How can I have suddenly gone down 2 inches? Something must be wrong. And she re-measured me and she found the machine was wrong. Anyway, I'm so glad I was back to my... So, you see, by worrying, you cannot add, like the Lord Jesus said, 1 inch or 2 inch to your stature. So why worry? Cast them all away. Those are the things that keeps you down, earthbound. Earthbound. Even waters, science tells us that even water on a bird's wings will not cause it to fly effectively. The bird will have to shrug away all those waters from its wings so that it can flap its feathers and lift up and fly. So cast away all that. When you come before the presence of the Lord, worship Him freely, until you feel that you're peaceful. Then make all your requests known unto God. Because at that moment, He comes and stands before you. And He will ask you, what you want. Amen.